since Howard Stern has moved off of terrestrial radio and gone to satellite, many of the FM stations around the United States now are claiming that they're free FM and they're free to say and do whatever they want, and that they're going to bring talk radio back into the FM market. Well, if that's so true, then how come they can't say things like titty, cocksucker, fuckbag, shithole, dickhead, and douchebag? See, the FCC is slowly but surely taking away our freedom of speech. Not necessarily to have curse words, but just to be able to speak what's on our mind. Cursing, in the right context, can be pretty funny. Unless you're a lame asshole who sits on your couch and eats potato chips all the time and gets offended by things like fat fuck. I'm Lou Gentile, the king of paranormal controversy, and I support Howard Stern's move to Sirius Radio. Go get your subscription now. Sirius.com.
Stop it? Probably not. Will I know what to do when it comes? For the passing years, You're about to enter my world, a world of exploration and knowledge. This is my life, a life I have unwittingly chosen. Welcome to the Lucian Tilly Show.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another live edition of the Lou Gentile Show with you here tonight, Wednesday, January the 18th, 2006. Got another open topic night for you tonight. And I'm probably going to have Ward on for a little while anyway. But if you want to get interactive during the show, you can go into the chat room at LouGentile.com and interact, click on live chat. You have to be a registered free member of the site in order to gain access to the chat room, and it's very easy to do. Registration is free. And just read the FAQ, the FAQ, at the top left-hand side of the site. It tells you exactly how to do it. It's very, very easy. It takes less than a couple minutes. And you can just, the whole site opens up into news and information and archives and podcasts and everything else. And a lot of it's free. I'm going to say 97% of the whole damn site now is free. The only thing it's not is the archives are $53.95 a year via PayPal. And let's see, we got open topic night tomorrow night as well, and then Friday night we have a special guest. I'll be putting their information up tomorrow night, and that's that. So let's see, we got old Uncle Ward here. Welcome, sir.
Hey, how you doing, Lil? What's up, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good. And yourself?
Good. I'm doing a lot better today.
Yeah.
Had a real fun chat yesterday too.
Well, I was up with Kevin last night.
Oh, yeah, what happened?
Till 3 o'clock in the morning. Yikes. And got everything done, and we're going to send it out tomorrow. Tomorrow afternoon via FedEx. And we have to do it. I think it's going to go over really, really well. I think the test that I have concocted for this is a test in itself. So we're going to see how it is, and how it goes over. What's this?
Yeah. There's a lot of hoops you have to jump through.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of legalities in it as well. I mean, I was on the phone with my attorney, you know, making sure of this and making sure of that, and then, you know, my agent and manager, and, you know, everybody's going crazy because they're like, well, this has to be done a certain way, and you want to make sure that they can't do this. So, I mean, you know, if they accept this, then, you know, I'm going to win. I can tell you that right now.
Yeah, this is
if they accept this challenge the way that I wrote it, I'm going to win.
can tell you that right now, regardless of our buddy in the chat's saying.
Well, that's good, because it seems like, especially with Kevin, you know, he's got this skeptical mind.
Oh, yeah.
But there's a lot of legalese, you know?
Oh, there definitely are.
A lot of legalese in the language, so that'll be great if they, I mean, it's, you know, so specific the way they want it, but, you know, like you said last night, I can understand. They have a ton of wackos.
Mm-hmm.
A ton.
Well, I mean, the way that I worded this, I'm doing it a certain way first to see if they will accept it, and if they accept it, that's fine. You know, we can work on the specifics at a later time. If they don't accept it, then I just reapply in 12 months.
Mm.
That's all.
Right.
I mean, that's how it is. I think the way that I worded it is fair to the skeptical community, and is fair to the paranormal community. And it just has to be done a certain way first. You know, like you said, there's a lot of hoops that have to be done with this. There's a lot of things that have to be taken into consideration when you're looking at going ahead and applying for this test, you know, for this challenge.
That's something else actually Jeff brought up, and I want to applaud you for that, too. You've really exceeded yourself again on the website. I mean, where everybody else is going for, you know, hey on everything, it's just fantastic what you've done. The more of the websites become free than ever before.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I tried to make it since the, I don't know, what is it, since December or whatever, the podcasts are all free. So, trying to do what I can to make it easier on people, because I know that everybody has their own problems and money's tight and everything else. Mm-hmm. And if they want to go back deeper in the archives, then they're just going to have to pay the $53.95 for it.
Yeah, it's worth it. There's a lot of great stuff in there.
You know?
There's a lot of best of shows, as a matter of fact. I was thinking of putting together like the top five or maybe top 10 shows that you've done. Just like making a list, you know?
Yeah, well.
I'd like to see you put them together too and say which ones have been your favorite, you know?
Yeah, well, you know. I'll try and put something together at some particular point, but right now it's just too freaking crazy. I got, I have production companies, pretty big production companies, wanting to do documentaries on this whole procedure of what's going on, because
you should absolutely, Luke, get it documented. Absolutely.
Well, I mean that's why I've been talking to these people. I actually talked to one of them today, and you know, I told him, I said, look, I said, you know, you follow this around. If I win, you're going to sell billions of copies of this. If I lose, you're going to sell millions of copies. So it's a win-win situation, regardless.
Absolutely.
Sure.
Either you're going to pass or you're not, and either story is fascinating to tell.
Sure.
You just don't go with that. The people who did that in search of the new series.
No, not at all.
That's Alan Landsberg or Land. I don't know what it is, but
no, they suck.
Big time.
They suck ass. Those people that did In Search of the new one, they blow.
You know, what sucks about that, too, because they originally did, that's the same people who did the original series in the 70s, and I don't know about you, but that series freaked me out when I was a kid.
That series was really, really good.
It
was really, really good, but then the new one came out, and I don't know, working with those people, there were a lot of affidavits that were signed, there were a lot of people that were involved with that. I think that too many people knew too much of everybody's business that was going on. And honestly, I just think it turned out to be a fucking nightmare. I really do. And I may just drop it. I may not even go after him for some of the things. Because, you know, one of the problems with before I was picked up and I had an agent and a manager was that, you know, I got fucked over on so many of these TV deals, it was unbelievable.
It's all just handshakes and words of honor. And you can't do that.
Not even that. I mean, it was just, you know, here's $200-$300 per diem. Have a nice day. Bend over, grab your ankles, and hold on. That's basically what it was. MTV did that all the way home.
Oh, man. I'm telling you, Viacom's the worst.
You know. I mean, honestly, I really don't even like MTV. I really don't.
Bite the hand that feeds me, but Viacom is just the lowest common denominator, man. They're bad. Hey, I didn't have a chance to send those DVDs out.
Well, send it out whenever you get a chance.
But don't worry, I'll be sending it out tomorrow.
That's fine.
I set up by the time, like, tomorrow off, so I'll be able to send it out here. For sure.
But yeah, so I mean, it's coming along. This whole thing though is coming along pretty good. And
can you get any of those other interviews that you did on the other radio shows on the podcast? You think?
What do you mean? Put them up?
Yeah, on the podcast.
Yeah, I'm trying to get a hold of them. See, the problem with these people is, you know, you tell them, listen, the only condition is that I have no problem coming on your show, but I just want I want it documented what I'm doing. So could you send me an MP3 or send me a CD? Well, you tell them, and it goes in one ear and out the other. They forget. They don't send you nothing out, and then you're just left, you know, holding yourself.
Yeah. I wanted to hear you with Randy. You know, you said you talked with him for a couple minutes.
Yeah.
I wanted to hear that conversation.
Yeah, well, I do, too. I want to hear it again. I'm waiting for it as well as everybody else.
Gosh dang it. Well, if you go on any shows, you find out, and they're streamed on the net, you know, let somebody know or let me know or something so we can record these things.
Well, a lot of times I get calls, man, from these people, and they're just like, okay, we'd like to have you on in a half hour. You know what I mean? And it's like, okay. And your point is? So.
Yeah, no, that's showbiz for you, man.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy. But it's just going to get, it's only going to get worse from here out, you know?
Well, I know. Well, once this thing is submitted and everything, I mean, it's going to be a little bit of a different story. So,
yeah, that's going to be a blast. Whole thing happened and unfold. It still is.
Oh, yeah.
So what's Kevin up to these days, man?
Kevin is just doing his thing, working and trying to make a living, and that's about it. Kevin's independent now. You know, before he was sucking his mom's tit. You know, about 2 years ago, and he was living at home, and then he branched away, and he said, he came to me one night, and he was like, well, you know, I really want to get out of my house, I don't know what to do. I said, well, then just leave. Tell your mom that you're going to get your own place and go. And that he did, and he got a job, and everything was fine, and then, you know, the next thing you know, he's just running into some financial problems, and like everybody does, switching jobs here and there, and, you know, and then that's that.
I love it. I didn't know you only knew for like 7 years. I thought you guys went back further than that.
No. Nope.
Because he was like, I mean, I've known you for about, well, the show anyway, for about 5 years. And it's like, wow, Kevin's only been on that one? Because it seems like he's been there forever.
Yeah, it might, you know, it might even be a year or two more. I'm not even sure. I mean, you know, I try so hard not to associate a time frame with friends and people that I know and associates, whatever. It's just because it's hard, because then if you say the wrong thing, you know, then they get offended, they get pissed off.
Lou, what were you doing with that? I was trying to remember that show you did with your father-in-law. I think it's aunt's dad.
Oh God,
that one show you brought him on, remember?
Mm-hmm.
He was talking about Bigfoot or something, and
oh yeah, he's a piece of work. He is.
What was that story you were saying about you were out in the woods and you were shouting out to Bigfoot or something? What was that all about?
Well, my old producer Joe Decker, he got it in his brilliant mind that he would set up a Bigfoot hunt with me, Dr. Robert Morgan, himself, and Morgan's documentarist or film guy, whatever the hell he is. And so I drive like 11 hours out to Ohio to this undisclosed location in the middle of friggin' nowhere. And I mean, it was cold out there. It must have been 10 degrees out that night. So I'm sitting out there, and I'm there with Robert and all this. Actually, it was like we got out there probably about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We go out there, and the first thing that happened was is that the camera crew guy, and I take notice of these things, but the camera guy goes out into the woods by himself. I'm like, you know, what is he doing? You know, why is he going out into the woods by himself, and why isn't he back here with us? So, you know, I acted like I didn't even, you know, notice that he left and everything. And all of a sudden, he comes back, and he was this big black guy. He was probably like, you know, 6 foot, 300 pounds, 350, whatever. He comes back, and he's like, let's go, you know, take a look back here and everything. And apparently, this was an area where Robert Morgan was you know, investigating Bigfoot and had gotten a lot of Bigfoot tracks and, you know, a lot of sightings of Bigfoot and everything. So I was pretty excited. You know, I'm figuring, well, fuck, I'm going to see Bigfoot, and I'm going to run after the bastard, and I'm going to tackle that ass, and I'm going to definitely, you know, win some money from somebody. You know, but I didn't tell nobody that. That was my intention. Because I seen anything in a suit, or I seen anything that looked like, or even resembled Bigfoot, my ass would have been like friggin', you know, a track star after that thing.
I said, go for it.
Yeah, so anyway, we're sitting there, and, you know, Robert's like, okay, well, let's go. We start walking, and all of a sudden, we come up to this big footprint, or we come up to this area. Let me put it to this way. We come up to this little area, and I'm looking around, and Robert's like, oh, now, out of all the fucking leaves and mud and everything else, he just goes right to the spot, and he's like, look, I think Yatehe was here. I said, wow, that's neat. He's like, yeah, it looks like a footprint. There was one footprint inside of mud, but it wasn't a footprint. I mean, you could barely make it out. It just looked like somebody with a pair of boots walked back there. Okay, and accidentally slipped in the mud in this one section. And I sat there and I looked and I'm like, oh, wow. I took a picture of it. The picture's around somewhere. It's probably on the website. I think it actually is. It's on the website under loose photographs. I think I'm pretty sure it is in there. But anyway, I'm looking at this thing and I'm like, man, this ain't no freaking Bigfoot track. If it is, you know, the guy, Bigfoot either has one leg or slipped and fell. One or the other. So we're walking around, you know, we're just, you know, seeing what's going on. I didn't hear nothing, didn't see nothing. So all of a sudden we go over to this one big clearing area, and it's now getting dark out. And we're sitting out there, freezing my ass off, and I'm looking around, nothing. It's about 7 o'clock at night, you know, I'm ready to pack it in. I am so cold that I can't feel my feet. My hands are numb. My cheeks feel like they're you know, pieces of ice. And all of a sudden, this light starts emanating from the woods. I'm like, what the hell is that? So, you know, Robert's there, and Joe's there, and Antoinette's there. You know, Antoinette was with me on this thing. And we're all looking, and I'm like, what the hell is this? I said, you know what? I said, Robert, come on, let's go. Let's go see what this is. Because Robert didn't want to go see what it was. I don't know if, you know, he was trying to trick me or whatever the hell was going on. But, you know, I said, come on, Robert, let's go see where this light's coming from. So we walk like a mile. Because where the light was coming from was, I'd say, about a quarter mile away. But you had to walk like a quarter mile to the left. And then a quarter mile towards the object or where this light was emanating from in order to get to it.
And you're going through freezing mud and all that?
No, it was like a clearing. It's kind of, you know how, like, you know how farmland's set up, right? You know, you have a big field, then you have a patch of woods. That's kind of how this place was set up. It was huge, but there was, like, you know, like a farmland, and then there was a big mile worth of woods, and then another piece of farmland, you know, for like 2-3 miles, and then another piece of, you know, maybe half a mile or mile worth of woods, and it was all situated like that. So as I'm sitting there, and I am walking with Robert, we're walking up to this place where the light is, and we couldn't find it. But what I saw was that there was like this little river there. And all of a sudden, this guy comes tutting down in a boat with a light.
That's what it was.
And I'm like, all right, well, I guess we found out the answer to our question of what that light was. The guy was spotting something. Maybe he was poaching. Who knows what he was doing? You know, he's poaching deer or, you know, whatever. Could have been anything. So I said, okay, no big deal. So we went back and we're out there. And all of a sudden, you know, Robert's there. And he's like, well, I'm going to try to contact Bigfoot. And I said, all right, you go do your thing, brother. And he's out there and he's like, Yatehe! Yatoquelo! And all this other shit, right? And I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe my balls are now starting to freeze. You know, listening to Robert. You know, Robert was an alright guy, but I'll tell you what happened later on. So anyway, he's out there and he's screaming into the fucking woods, right? And there's nothing going on. I mean, nothing's answering us back. And, you know, if you heard a friggin' leaf drop on the ground, he was like, "Did you hear that? I think he's trying to make contact." And I'm like, "All right, well, let me try, Robert. Let me see what I can come up with." And so I go up to the edge of the woods, and you know, I'm sitting there and I got my hands up to my mouth and I'm like, "Yatta-hey! Hello! Hello, quello!" Whatever the hell he was telling me to say, I forget. And nothing happened. So then I get my EVP recorder out, which, you know, it's probably frozen at this point. So I don't even know how credible you could even say that it was. And I start recording, you know, just whatever's around, and I got some pretty weird noises on it. And for the life of me, I can't find a friggin' thing. It's around here somewhere, but
was it your the new ones or was it an older?
No, it was the recorder that I use now. It was the recorder that I use now, yeah, and it was just really weird. And it really honestly sounded like something was answering Robert back when he was in the background doing what he was doing. And I actually came back from that trip and announced it on the air and played them on the air, and I'd have to listen to the shows after I went out on that trip with Robert, because right after I posted them on the website, I had put the audio up. But anyway, so little did I know, unbeknownst to me, as I usually get fucked over by these people, the point wasn't for Lou to go out there and have a Bigfoot experience. That wasn't the intention of everybody but me and Antoinette. What the intention was from Robert and Joe Decker and this other guy was to hook up and for Robert to talk to Joe to pull him away from me, because Joe was doing a great job for my show back then and he was doing it for free. And Robert saw that and sucked Joe into working for him on that AARF fucking nightmare that was a flop.
What's that, AARF?
I don't know, the American Anthropological Foundation fucking society or something. I have no clue. But anyway, so I get back. And I'm sitting there listening to Joe on the phone, and he's like, "Well, you know, Lou, I think you should join AARF. Robert has, you know, said that he wants me to join, and if I work for free now, I could be making $90,000 next year." And I said, "You know what, Joe? Your head is gonna fucking fall right off." I said, "Because you're now getting a big head, you're doing this stuff for me, you're meeting these people, you're setting all this stuff up. Now you're becoming what I told you not to get involved with. You're getting personal with the guests, mm-hmm. and you're now starting to, you know, show them what you're doing for me, and they're coming to you, and now you're going to fuck everything all up." "Oh, no, 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 I'm still going to do the radio show for you. I'm just going to do this on the side." I said, "All right, no problem. Do it on the side. Do what you got to do," I said, "but, you know, I'm just telling you my thoughts and feelings right now." Because Joe and I were pretty tight. You know, the same, almost the same way as Lone Feather, except I was going over to this guy's house and, you know, birthday parties for the kids and barbecues and all that other crazy shit. So we start getting all this stuff ready for AARF, and I think I was in the middle of filming something. I'm not sure what it was. I know I was filming something. And I'm through, you know, I'm going through filming, and Joe keeps emailing me, "Lou, you got to get this contract signed for AARF." And I'm reading it, and I'm like, "There's no fucking way I'm going to sign this contract. There's no way. I mean, I'm not giving my exclusive rights out to anybody." All this other stuff that was in there. So, anyway, I just let it pass. Joe comes back to me, like, a week later. I can't believe you didn't sign it. Robert is mad. You know, he wanted you to become a part of that. We're all going to be millionaires. We're going to start up we're starting this up and that. I said, "Look, Joe, I've seen this happen 100 times before with this show. Somebody who is a semi-celebrity or author celebrity or, you know, real celebrity or whatever, whoever works for me sees stars in that person's eyes. They go after them. The person sees what they do for me. They scarf them up. They try to get them to do all kinds of stuff for them for free, and they fucking leave them out to dry. I says, you have just now fallen into that category. Well, that's fucking bullshit. What are you talking about? I'm not doing it. I said, yes, you are, Joe. You're fucking me over is what you're doing. You're now, you know, you're now taking what I have given you and using it for your own personal benefit, okay, to fit your own model and working for somebody that you don't even know. You have no clue what this guy is. All you know is that the fucking guy's out in the middle of Montana looking for Bigfoot. That's all you know. Oh, well, you know, we have this and that. We have a board of directors and all this. I said, I don't give a shit if you guys, you know, are a bunch of astronauts and you're going to go to the moon. Doesn't matter to me. I've seen it happen before. And he's like, well, you know, I just think that it's better off that we don't talk to each other. I said, fine, fuck you then. See ya. So we didn't talk for years. So every intermittently, you know, I know he listens to the show intermittently. I know that Joe... you know, and Joe was a good guy. He was a good guy with a great heart. You know, we helped each other out. We were friends at that particular point, but he fucked me over, like most people wind up doing, because they see these celebrities or these people that are, you know, are authors or have a lot of following to them. And that, you know, depending upon that guest or that author, they will see what they're doing for me and they will try to scarf them up. I mean, I've had... I can't tell you how many times, and this is the one thing that I respect about Ariel. You know, Ariel may have been a bitch in the chat, and she may have been a douchebag, you know, talking to people and things like that. But one thing I respect about her, she told me when people were doing that. She would straight up tell me.
Yeah, but I thought she was taking, you know, accepting, like, free memberships here and...
Well,
free,
she
you know,
was.
ISP
she was, but you got to understand, I overlooked a lot of that. You know what I mean? I kind of like, you know, as long as I don't find out about it, I don't really give a flying shit. You know? That's how I had to look at it. Because you have to understand my predicament. I have somebody booking me guests
right.
Every night. I have everything about that guest in my inbox. All their numbers, I mean, the success rate for her shows was probably 90%, meaning that 10% of all the shows that she's ever booked were either rescheduled wrong or, I mean, scheduled wrong, or they had some kind of, you know, goofy-ass phone number that was wrong, or there was a scheduling conflict, something to do with that. So it was, she was about 10%, you know, of all of the guests that she had booked. Were messed up.
Is that good or bad?
I thought that was pretty good. I didn't think it was fair. I mean, everybody who has done work for this show, I think they've all done a hell of a job in trying to book guests and do things like that. It's just that when it comes to when it comes to their own personal fucking agenda, that it gets in the way.
Mm-hmm. Was because that your you got right then?
What's this?
Was that your producer right then?
What do you mean?
That you just said thanks.
Oh, yeah. So, you know, it's kind of a fucked up situation where you have people helping you out, doing the best that they can, and then all of a sudden they get greedy because they want Lou to pay them $1 million a year. And Lou ain't got $1 million a year to pay you. You know?
Maybe this year.
Yeah, well, you never know. But, you know, so that's kind of how it went. I mean, you know, Ariel, yeah, she was a douche, and she did some slimy things behind the doors. But, you know, I had heard through the grapevine a little bit about what was going on, and I said to myself, you know what, the lady really isn't getting paid jack shit to do the show. So let's just go ahead and you know, whatever happens, happens. And then I started finding out other things that were going on.
Well, she was gung-ho on alternate medicine and psychics.
She what?
I mean, she was gung-ho on alternate medicine and psychics.
Well, yeah, I mean, you got to understand, the lady was in a wheelchair, and, you know, she was eating tuna fish all the time. I have no idea. She was probably, out of all the people that I have ever met on the Internet, and I've known hackers all the way to people that... you know, have been anonymous because they've worked in Area 51 or they worked in some branch of the NSA or whatever. She was the most anonymous person that I've ever met.
Wow.
Didn't know. Only thing that I had of hers was her phone number. Didn't even know if that was even right. Tell you the truth. You know, I find it interesting that when I start something, everybody follows along the line. Do you notice now that everybody's like, ooh, we have a paranormal radio network. Come and see and listen.
Actually, you know, it is funny. There's a lot more, well, this has happened over the past couple of years, but there's a lot more paranormal stuff that's popped up. You know, specifically like, you know, people trying to make, you know, multiple shows, that sort of thing.
Make a network.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Yeah. That's what they're doing.
You know what's really cool?
Why the fuck am I the only one that has to come up with these ideas, and then these people copy it, and they want to be like fucking Lou Gentili? And honestly, I mean, you know, I've listened to a lot of these different shows, and I hear the persona, because all these people, they all put on a persona. Every last fucking one of them.
You know what's cool, though? You got Dreamland and Kevin Smith.
Yeah,
I was listening to those shows independent of your show before you got them.
Yeah, they're quality shows, I think.
Yeah, and it's fantastic. Absolutely, and I was.
Yeah,
like,
and I don't want to rule out Dr. Ed Kraft. I don't want to rule him out because
that are really good. I just
handpicked Ed because you know I heard Ed's voice, and I said, well, the guy has a lot of talent. He seems like he has his shit together.
Yeah,
and I think he could have a nice show. You know, Jim Lowry, you know, that was like, you know, trying to get a fucking hillbilly to go to New York City and, you know, go to a strip club. It was just fucking impossible. How y'all doing there? This is Jim Lowry. Doing the same shit that I did. I said, Jim, why don't you get off my dick and go ahead and have your own show? Your show's starting to sound exactly like mine. And welcome to ESPN Frontier Radio. How you doing there, everybody? And you're all right. I was like, oh, come on, give me a break. Give me a fucking break.
Yeah,
you know,
really
coming out with the DVDs like he's some fucking, you know, outrageous fucking ghost hunter from down south. Give me a fucking break. You know, and this is what I'm talking about. See, you know, if anybody should be capitalizing off of this industry, it should be fucking me. I should have 20 DVDs on my website. Hey, see Lou Gentili get 600 EVPs of the fucking demon from the 16th quadrant from hell on this case. You know, but I don't. But yet I'm an asshole. I'm an asshole because I speak my mind, and I'm an asshole because I don't sell a whole shitload of products on my thing. And then when I sell a friggin' course on my website, I get emails from people, I can't, you know, don't you think $200 is a lot of money? Fuck no, it's not. Not for 2 hours of audio for 16 fucking hours worth.
The lack of merchandise on your site is actually really refreshing.
I mean, you know, I don't have pop-ups, and, you know, who do I mean, you know, I got some supported books that I put up there that, you know, I think people should take a look at and read intermittently, and that's no big deal.
Every time I've been on there, I mean, other than, you know, one book I haven't seen before, the other stuff has been like, you know, John Zappas. I'm like, yeah, rock and roll, that's legit stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I promote anything that John has, and I would never have a problem with you know, going ahead and, I mean, if John was selling, you know, shit that came out of his ass that he put, you know, in a box, I would sell it on the site. No, I'm serious, because I mean, yeah, I wouldn't really sell shit, but I mean I would seriously, you know, promote products of John's of whatever he came out, because I know John.
If it was haunted, would you?
Well, it'd be a different story. You know.
Or maybe blessed, then it would be holy.
That would be, yeah, it'd be holy shit. But you know, I mean, it's, you know, you have all these different radio shows that are out there that have been biting off my dick for years. I mean, every single one of them knew who I was. Every one of them when I contacted them. Oh, my God, I can't believe Lou Gentili. Give me a break. I'm just a fucking average, normal, everyday person. And these people are acting like, oh, my God. Then they wind up sticking it up my ass anyway. You know, I hear, you know, you hear all this bullshit from these hosts, and they sit there and they're like, well, you know, the lack of contradiction is the leading path to truth. I'm like, okay, douchebag. You know what? You're such a fucking brilliant idiot. Why don't you get out of your fucking truck and go on an investigation and see what it's really like instead of trying to put people's feet to the fucking fire? Okay?
Give me a break. Oh, that's good.
And we're gonna have on one of Ariel's returning guests to the Lou Gentili show again for the 680th time. Boo hoo. Spooky, scary, and smells like bats. Next up.
Oh, Lou, that was funny. Oh, man.
But it's the truth. It's absolutely the truth. And see, you know, I speak my mind like this, and, you know, if I wasn't getting fucked over from every which way but loose, you know, with these people, that's why the people that I have, that's it. That's it. That's all it is. I mean, Brian Vike actually just left. Brian Vike just sent me an email tonight, and he stated that he was, you know, I don't want to get into it, but that he was having some issues with his personal life, and, you know, he wanted to spend more time with his family, which I have no problem with.
Sure.
You want to spend more time with your family, that's fine. So I go to his website. My link's off of there, right? Rents and Yancey's link are up there. I'm like, what the fuck is this?
He took your link off?
Yeah. On the main page. So I don't know what the deal is. I mean, you know, but that's no big deal. I mean, I'm not worried about that. I mean, honestly, you know, probably you know, James's show is a better fit for his schedule because it's the weekend. And I can understand that. You know, he probably can do an interview on the weekend. You know, Rents, I think he's scheduled on the weekend as well. I think he did all his Monday through Friday interviews, like, you know, during the week. And I think he got rid of him. I'm not saying anything bad about Brian. I mean, I'm definitely not saying that. But, you know, the man was doing a lot. I mean, if anybody was doing a lot of interviews, it was him. He was
That's
all the
strange.
He, you know, he was all the time.
The second one right down on the webpage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's not there anymore because he's not going to be on the show anymore, and he's not going to. Well, I mean, I shouldn't say that he's not going to be on the show anymore. He's not going to have his monthly spot.
His monthly, okay.
Right, he's not going to have his monthly spot, and he's not going to have his bike report. He can't do that either.
Yeah, I said, well, you know, it was just, man, those were just basically, you know, just phone interviews that he'd just ask questions about, and they were informative and fun.
I mean, it was entertaining after Whitley's show. It was fine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was fine
to
listen to some of these people.
The lightest of all the content, but
yeah,
you know, you really got an awesome lineup right now. You really do. It's cool because those are like two other shows that I always try to catch all the time. I mean, you know, I craft two and all that stuff, but the two, I'm just telling you, before I came over to your show, I always try to catch you and Dreamland and Kevin Smith's show when I could.
Right.
And it's like, wow, how in the hell did Lou get these guys? This is awesome.
Yeah, and I mean, even my trader listeners, you know, that wind up in you know, in other chat rooms all around the internet, I know who they are. I know who the ones who are looking for information to go back and run and tell the different hosts what I say about them. I know all about it. I've known about this shit for years.
Yeah, you're always one step ahead so you can plant information.
Yeah, and it doesn't really matter because they keep coming back, so whatever. It's no big deal.
Yeah.
But I like to think that I have a loyal fan base. I mean, when I get pissed off at somebody, I think the fans get pissed off. I mean, why that is, I'll never figure that out, but... Yeah, I don't recommend people do that.
Well, people identify with you. It's like it's the same thing. I mean, and you know, there's some people in there who are just super, super defensive. And actually, you know, I got to tell you, in all honesty, Lou, as far as fans are concerned, you do have some fanatics. You know that?
Oh yeah.
And you know, this is going to surprise you, but you know, I think is a bigger fan of yours than anybody. And I mean this. It's Artist 46.
You really think so, huh?
That guy friggin' worships the ground you walk.
Yeah, but why is he such a douchebag in the chat?
He just is sometimes. But I'm telling you, man, him and Jerry are like crazy defenders. I mean, they're just nuts about you. You know that?
I guess.
They are. You got so many great listeners, though, man.
I guess. I mean, you know, 20 or 30 of them hang out in the chat room every night. But... I wish that would change. I'd love to see 60, 70 people inside of there every night.
Oh, man, it will.
But you know what? Yeah, but honestly, I don't think, I think they're, and I've thought about this for years. Because you got to remember, I was on radio, then the internet, then radio and the internet, and then radio, internet, shortwave, and radio, internet, satellite, shortwave. I mean, I did the whole thing. I think it takes a certain caliber of a person to go in that chat room. I really do. Because I have looked and seen how many people are listening live to this show, and I have said to myself, I cannot fucking believe that I only have 35, 40 people inside of this chat room. This is just, it is absolutely an equation that I cannot figure out.
Yeah, it's probably like 1/20th of the people listening, probably.
It's just nuts.
Mm-hmm.
It's absolutely nuts.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when you look at some of the other chat rooms that I've been into, even like Coast to Coast AM, you might have 50, 60 people. Now, how many people listen to that show? Supposedly, what, 7, 8 million? And they only have 50, 60 people in the chat room? What's that tell you? Something the fuck is up. That's what it tells me.
Yeah, that's true. You got a little fan base. People like to listen to you. You always vary things up, and sometimes you have some amazing info, and, you know, it's just stuff that you never really thought about, and you go, wow, you know?
Yeah.
How can this be? I mean, that's what the whole point of your show is, really. Makes you kind of question everyday life.
Well, I think that probably, and I've been told this before, and I'm not biting Howard Stern's dick when I say this, but people just kind of say that the way that I approach my radio show is kind of the way that Howard Stern approaches his. I'm honest with the listeners. I say what's on my mind, you know, and that's kind of how it is. I mean, but even though Howard's putting on a persona when he goes on the air, I don't. So,
yeah.
In a sense, when people meet me, they're scared. They're like, oh, shit, is this guy going to, like, flip out on me, or is he going to, like, you know, tell me to go, you know, pound off or whatever? So who knows?
No, you're what you see is what you get. I mean, I've talked to you off the air. You're the same person. There is no persona. It'd be too hard for you to have to try and remember, you know, who you are.
Oh, I know. I know. That's the last thing I need.
It's the same thing like with lying. I mean, at a point you get, it's like you can't keep track of everything.
Yeah.
If you just tell the damn truth, you don't have to worry about that stuff.
What?
Chat room's just going nuts. Shouldn't have said anything about anybody in there.
Why?
Oh, nothing. You know, it's just funny to watch. I like the whole interactiveness of this whole thing. That's the thing, Lou. People work all day. I know I do. And you come back to this, and you just want to unwind and have fun.
Yep.
And it's almost like, this is like a big, huge bar, basically.
Well, that's kind of like how Al treats it, except Al is totally trashed all the time. He can't fool me. He's trashed. He tells me he's not trashed. He's trashed all the time. He's got at least a buzz going on when he's in that chat room or he goes on the air. Definitely.
Everybody's got their own personas. I mean, like, there's great people in there. It's like a little family. It really is. And it's people hanging out, saying how you doing. It's just great to see everybody in there.
It's good when people see. You know, I have always, since day one, had a chat room of some sort where people could. I mean, I remember when I used to have two people inside of a chat room. When I first went on the internet, I was lucky if I had five listeners. And it was just crazy. And I'd sit there and I'd look in the chat room and I'd look at my real server that I paid $6,000 for that I'd like to, you know, commit suicide over. And I sat there and I went, oh my God, you know, there's like five people that are listening. This has got to get better someday. And I've always just kept going and going and going and going and going.
It did.
You know, I've never liked when people, I don't know, I could be a lot bigger than I am right now.
Sure.
A lot, lot, lot bigger. If I would have done things a different way. If I would have promoted my, let's say, if I would have promoted people listening online and you know, went with these crazy ass, you know, people that had came to me and said, oh, Lou, we want to get your show on our internet radio station. And I'm like, well, how many listeners you got? Well, we just started out. We got like 500. I'm like, bullshit. I know. I started this. I know exactly what it is. When you start up, you'd be lucky if you have 10. It takes a while to get a fan base, to get people listening in, especially with talk radio. Music is a different story. But talk radio is its own unique, especially paranormal talk radio, is its own unique genre in itself.
Oh, absolutely. This is about as narrow, you know,
yeah,
narrow as you can get. But it's not always narrow. It's like right now, we're not doing paranormal. We're just talking
right.
about, you know, what's happening.
We're just hanging out, chilling, and actually, from what I see, people enjoy that. People enjoy hearing me going to rants on the air and, you know, telling people to go screw themselves and everything else. But
Well, it's like you said, it's the good and the bad. It's the same thing. At least you can, for all the crap you have to go through the day, you can come back here and go, you know, what's up with Lou? What's up with my friends? I mean, it's the same sort of thing. Like last week when I had that, you know, terrible time. And, you know, one of the I don't want to say who, but a friend in chat, I met in chat, gave me a call and said, how are you, you know?
Yeah.
It was just great to, like, wow, this person's completely unrelated to my normal life. You know, all the way back, he's, it's like, wow, I really appreciated that, you know?
Well, I can tell you that, you know, that's probably one of the reasons why a lot of people don't go into the chat room is because there a lot of people in the, I guess the only way I can explain this is by saying it like this. A lot of people in this field who want to explore the paranormal, who want to listen to paranormal talk radio, who want to look at UFOs, Bigfoot, cryptozoology, you know, ghosts, demons, poltergeists, whatever, they feel as though they have to be anonymous when they listen to it. Anonymous. And that's the truth. And this is what I've come up with over years. That people feel that they have to be anonymous because they don't want to associate themselves with the genre in case something happens. So in other words, you have somebody who is from wherever, Washington State, and they maybe have a haunting, or maybe they like researching the paranormal. Well, they'll listen and they won't come into the chat room because they don't want people to either know who they are, or they just don't feel like interacting with people because they're, you know, semi-lonely, or they just very shallow, whatever. And I'm not saying that my audience is shallow at all, but I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that just people want to remain anonymous.
No, it's the same thing. It's like when you ask for, you know, everybody, come on, send your pictures in. So many people don't want to send their pictures in, and damn, I could care less. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. Maybe it's what I'm going through and stuff, but I really feel like this is just a little family here, and it's people that I can... you know, even if they piss me off or upset me, it's just people who share common interest, and we hang out here and we talk. And
right, and it's like artist 46. If he was my son, you know, and he worked for me, he must have been fired already 10 times.
Right.
You know, I've banned him from the chat 10 times, and yet I keep letting him back in.
It's like that time when you're going in between Ariel and Sally, and in between that time, and then after Sally, when that whole thing happened, there was like a couple of weeks there that, you know, you weren't on.
Right.
And sometimes it was complete silence, or it was a repeat. And I'm telling you, man, there was a whole group. I mean, it was Al, Jane, me, Godzilla, you know, a bunch of people who were in there. We just kept coming back, and we just talked. We talked to each other. We talked about the show. We hang out in there, and it's like, it's great, man. It's a family in there.
Well, I mean, most people want to know what's going on. I mean, one of the freedoms that I have now is that I'm not constrained to having to 100% have to do the show. If I have to take off, I can take off.
Mm-hmm.
I can leave, do what I got to do, and that's that. Before, I'd have to listen to, well, there was dead air, what the fuck is going on here, you know, we had to run a commercial or a show from last week, you know, this is getting old, and I'm saying to myself, you know, kiss my ass, because I just do what I want. That's it.
Awesome, man.
I mean, I do what I want. That's it. That's how it's called, the Lou Gentile Show, not the anything else show. What I want.
The minute this becomes a responsibility or burden, and it's not a love anymore, that's when you go, hey, I'm done.
Exactly. And believe me, I have given it a lot of thought last year. of just saying, you know what, I want to throw the towel in. I don't want to do this anymore. There's too many people out there that just want to be assholes and are trying to screw me over. I'm trying whatever I can do, and it seems like I'm the only one trying to put all this together, and everybody else is just reaping the benefits. And I really went through, you know, maybe it was those 2 weeks that I was off the air when I went through that. But I was just like, you know, fuck this. I really did. I wanted to throw in the towel. And then I thought about it. And I said, you know what? I've been doing this for a long time. And there's one thing that I have always done. And that's I've never given up. I've never given up. Even though I may be, you know, going to another avenue of broadcasting this year. Or maybe that I wanted to drop all my affiliates and just, you know, that was it. I just didn't want to give up. And so I came back and I kind of looked at it in a different perspective. And I looked at all of the, I looked at all that I had accomplished with just the show. I went ahead and I looked at the different radio shows that were out there, and I said, you know, these people all know who I am. They started their thing. They have a little bit of knowledge. They went ahead and they started the radio show. They may know whatever it is. That's fine. But I looked at it and I said, you know, I kind of like started all this. I started these. I kind of like these people like looked at me and they were like, well, I want to do that. And they did it. And that's fine. What I didn't like was just the fact that, you know, I would do things for people that I never had the opportunity to. And you got to understand, the road that I had in broadcasting was an absolute positive fucking nightmare. Because I could not get any, I couldn't pay anybody to run this show. And it wasn't because of the content of the show, the way that it was put together, wasn't because of my voice, wasn't because of the way that I presented the field. It was because of one thing, and one thing only, because it had the name paranormal attached to it. And when people heard paranormal, they got scared.
Yeah, now it's like wildfire, but back then it was...
No, it's not like wildfire, believe it or not. Not in radio. Not in radio. In radio, it is still taboo.
Let me tell you something, man. I listened to a show today. I don't even know the name of it. I don't even want to say the name. I'll tell you the name off the air. It's got a picture of this guy. He's got the you know, real bitchin' Sennheiser mic. All the broadcast stuff. Beautiful looking studio. For all I know, it's a publicity photo. But the guy has a bunch of archives, right? Bunch of big name hosts. I've never even encountered him before. I pull up a couple archives and listen to him, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you, this is the most amateurish thing I've ever heard.
What was it?
Some Otto, the Edge, Otto somebody.
Mm.
The Edge Radio, something like that.
Okay.
Somebody by the name of Otto. Anyway.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
I was stunned at how bad it was. First of all, the production was terrible, number one. But two, this guy really did not have a clue what he was asking.
No.
I mean, I heard in an interview, it's going to identify me now, I made a post at a forum, or the guest book, it was awful, it was terrible. This
yeah.
guy had was interviewing interviewing Dr. David Jacobs, like he did.
Right.
This guy was clueless about his questions. I mean, with your questions, you try and establish your base for your listeners, right?
Right.
You're trying to establish, okay, who is this guy, where does he come from?
Well, I mean, the whole thing about this is that I'm an investigator. I know this field. So when I question the guests, I ask how I would ask a client. What's going on in their house? How do you know? Da 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 da. It takes experience. See, I've never, ever, 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 ever went on the air with a script and said, okay, I have to ask these questions. There was one time where I had a piece of paper in front of me. I'll admit, I had a piece of paper in front of me, and it was during the Edgar Froese show from Tangerine Dream.
Yeah. You don't want to mess that up, right?
And I said to Edgar, I said, you know what, Edgar, I got this piece of paper in front of me, and I really can't stand when people do this to me. I said, so you know what, and I crumbled it up, and I said, that's it. I'm going to start asking you real questions. And I think he damn near shit himself. Because his agent was just like, you know, livid afterwards. And I had to lean into his ass. And I'm saying, you know what? That was the best interview that Edgar had ever had before on the radio. Because one thing I understand about radio, a lot of times these publicists, they will, or agents, will give you ultimatums in order to get these people on the show. Or a lot of times these publicists or agents will give you questions and say you cannot deviate from these questions. Like one time I was going to have Tom Cruise on.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
And his publicist says to me, she says to me, she says, well, if Tom goes on your show, you're going to need to submit to me the questions that you're going to ask Tom, and we will send you back a fax that's going to have the questions and the answers so that you know in advance of what's going to happen. And I said, okay, no problem. So I put down like 10 questions because really when I got on the air, I was just going to rip them up. And by that point, they couldn't do anything. And I said to the publicist, I faxed it over and everything was fine. And she faxed it over and I got the answers. And I'm looking at these answers and I'm like, Tom did not write these answers. There's no way. There's absolutely no way. So I wrote her an email and I said, look, I said, there's absolutely no way that the Tom Cruise that people that I know wrote what you just faxed me. And she's like, well, you know, this is how it is. This is what you got to do. And I said, well, then I'm not going to have him on the show. I mean, I could have had him on the show very easily. Anybody who's listened to the show for a while knows that I have had the head of the Scientology, the Church of Scientology on the show. Very good friends with a lot of celebrities, John Travolta, Tom Cruise, people like that. And, that was my door in. Or my way in through the door, if you're dyslexic, like me. But, I sometimes I've rejected things like that. I had opportunities to interview a lot of different people, a lot of different celebrities, because, let's face it, authors are pretty interesting, but, you know, when you go to celebrities, you kind of want to find out where they're coming from. And, you know, with some big-name celebrities, it's a little bit difficult to get things on the roll, but for the most part, you can do it. And I just really didn't want to go through the hassle of having those questions and... It takes a lot of time. See, you might not think, but you know, I mean, producing a show and putting the show together sometimes is a really, really, really big pain in the ass.
No, it is. I know, man. Believe me, I actually do know this stuff. I mean, I have some experience with it. I'm glad. I'm much happier when you do the interviews with the people you're actually friends with or people who have something interesting to say. But I mean. I just—it's the whole actors and that whole thing. It's just—it's sickening to me, man. I can't stomach those kind of interviews, you know.
Well,
but the point.
Well, I mean, what about Sid Haig? I mean, what do you think about Sid Haig?
Oh, that was—you know that guy. It was an interesting interview.
Yeah.
If you were to sit down with the I mean, granted, he's a big name star and everything else, but
how many times would you get? Okay, ask yourself this question: if you were me, right? Uh-huh. And you walk into a hotel, into a five-star hotel, getting ready to do a convention, and the first person every time when they're there to greet you is Sid Haig. How would you feel?
I don't know. He sounds like a great guy.
It's just weird.
I mean, he sounds like a fun guy.
Yeah, it's just weird though because. This was happening before I even got him on the show. Never even mentioned to have him on the show.
Mm.
But Sid used to specifically wait in the lobby for me to get there.
That's cool.
And as soon as I would get there, we would just start talking. And then maybe start drinking a little bit. And then start talking and then maybe drink a little bit more. And then start talking. And the next thing you know, Sid would disappear. And like, you know, the next day or that night, like 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning... Sid's walking around. I'm like, don't you ever sleep?
And I tell you, he's an exception in the rule, man. Because I
see that. That's why I'm saying that the horror genre is the best genre out there.
Maybe it is, but I just don't,
these actors, Ward, that are in these horror films for the most part are down to earth, real nice people. They really are.
I'm telling you, man. Do not put your faith in actors. They're the worst friggin' people on the planet, and I'm including family in that. Just don't, man. They'll burn you every time. And if it isn't in a year, it'll be in two or three or four.
No. You're not following what I'm saying. You got to understand, this is coming from experience with other actors and actresses.
Well, maybe
what I am saying is that in the horror genre, okay, when you go to these horror conventions, anybody who's in my audience right now that has ever went to a horror convention, I am sure that they have seen the actors that have been in some of these big movies interacting with their fans over drinks, smoking cigarettes, chilling out, having a good time, relaxing. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
When you go to some of these other conventions, you don't see that. They sign their stuff and they run and hide. That's what I'm saying. I'm not saying to put your whole heart inside of these people. Would I trust Sid Haig? Yes, I would. I personally would trust Sid Haig because I've known him for a couple years. He's been to my house as well as his fiance and other, you know, other celebrities have been over my house, and I've talked to them and had barbecues and all. It's a little bit different when you get into that area, but when you get into you know, trusting them as far as you know, not knowing them, no, that's a different story.
Well, the thing is, I'm just saying, Louis, you got to realize that, you know, people tend to deify that whole thing of acting. You know, we see them on the big screen, we go, oh, they
right.
must know something we don't. We, oh my gosh,
right.
You know, they must know, it ain't that way, buddy.
That's right.
They're there because they have an ego, number one, and they want people to like them. They want people to, hey, look at me, I'm up here, you know?
No, not a lot of them, believe it or not.
Every single, look at, man, I work in Hollywood.
I know you work in Hollywood, but the people that I have encountered, Angela Bettis. Okay, I'll give you Angela Bettis as an example. Okay? Angela Bettis, when she did Girl Interrupted with, who the hell was in that movie?
Winona Ryder.
Angelina Jolie and all that. She's friends with Angelina and everybody else in there. Okay. When I met Angela Bettis, she was just down to earth. I sat in Angela Bettis's hotel room with her for 4.5 hours talking to her about this stuff on a personal level, straight up, for 4.5 hours.
Did she know who you were before? Yeah?
No, she had no idea who I was. But then, you know, I was, see, because you got to understand, there's a fan area of conversation with people and where you go and where you don't go with a celebrity, and then there's like a celebrity area where you can go and you can't go. You know what I mean?
I can't even stand to talk about this stuff.
I know.
I can't. Listen,
but
I
see, you're looking at it over there with all the fucking, you know, crazy stuff that goes on over there. I'm looking at it in just a small group of people. I'm only talking about 15, 20 actors that I personally know. That's all I'm talking about. I mean, I know how these people are. I'm not going to talk about Angela Bettis to the extent of what she does for work and things like that, but I mean, I have been with Angela when people have, you know, made her offers and she's just refused, saying, well, you know, I really don't want to do it. I just want to do my own thing. I want to explore myself. These are the kind of people that I get involved with. They don't want to be up on the screen because they want to see them fucking selves up there and go, hey, how you doing? I'm this and that. I hang out with the kind of people that are creative enough to say, you know what, yeah, I did that, that's fine, you know, and I'll probably get something else down the line, but I want to do this creative part of myself and explore myself.
Just haven't met him yet. Yeah. But let me ask you this, Lou. Look, something I don't understand is, with the crap that you've been through, I mean, real stuff, the stuff you deal with really every day that has the potential to occur, I mean, the terrible stuff, the stuff when you're waking up and you're seeing a face and you're hearing a growl, why in the hell are you interested in horror after that?
Why am I interested in horror?
Yeah,
the
it's
genre?
Just entertainment. Yeah.
Put it to you this way. I was the first, as I stated before, and it's documented, person in the ghost hunting community, ghost busting community, to do a horror convention. Somebody said to me, I actually contacted somebody and said, listen, I think what I do would fit in what you have. And they said, well, I don't know. I don't see how that could fit. And I explained it to them. And they're like, okay. That actually sounds like a cool idea. Now, I'm going to tell you the reason why I did that. In order to get information out, in order to interact with the public, in order to show people that these things are real, you have to have people that already have some kind of an interest in what you're doing. Now, out of all the different genres out there, golf, fucking Star Trek, what genre do you think may have just a little bit of interest in what I do?
You mean between golf or Star Trek?
No, I mean just all the different genres out there. Out of all the different genres, what do you think... What kind of genre do you think is out there that would have a little bit of interest in what I do?
Yeah, of course. I know where you're going with this.
The horror genre.
Sure, of course.
Right?
But look, that's entertainment.
I'm not going to go to a comic book convention.
No, that's going to lead to more interesting things. But let me tell you something else. This is what's interesting. For 3 years now, the film industry has suffered a 20% loss in revenue.
Mm-hmm.
I heard someone say a very good point. Any other business that's managed to run like this would be pulling their hair out trying to figure out why in the hell are we losing 20% of our customers.
Right.
They're not coming back. Guess where they're going, Lou?
Mm-hmm.
There's a ton of other alternate entertainment out there. And for me, it is a hell of a lot more entertaining and interactive for me to sit down and listen to a show for 2 hours on the radio or on the internet and get into a chat room and talk with friends and talk with someone who knows what the hell is going on.
Right.
And it is for me to sit down and watch a movie that's going to be bastardized to hell.
Well, yeah, and I understand that. But, you know, you have to understand the way that I'm thinking when I do this stuff. See, yeah, it's great to have an interactive radio show, but that's what it is. It's radio. You can't see it.
Wait, Luke, stop right there. Dude, don't you understand that what you're doing right now is the future? This is what's happening. This is pioneering. The stuff.
I understand that. It's being interactive. It's getting involved with the audience. I mean, I'm talking to you. How many times have I talked to you?
Well, a bunch of times.
Right.
I've lost track.
Exactly.
I've lost track.
But this is how it is. So, what's stopping other people who don't have that opportunity, like TV, like, let's say, the Horror Channel, okay? See, one thing you have to understand, the Horror Channel is not like these other networks. That'd be like if you and I started up a paranormal TV network, we would do things different than all the other TV networks, right?
Mm-hmm.
If we could find the money.
Sure.
But let's say if we had $80 million and we put it all together, we would have a really kick-ass network, right? Because we're involved in it.
It's just funny. His drama, the make-believe stuff, just doesn't pull.
I understand that, but you got to understand that the things that I deal with, you can't have them on the friggin' golf channel. You can't have them on the woman's network.
Well,
I'm involved
with. You could have them on a paranormal channel.
Yeah, you could, but you know you're gonna have to start that up. The closest thing to a paranormal channel I have is the horror channel.
Yeah, that's true.
You follow me? I mean, you have to understand the content that's going to be on there. The content, yeah, it's going to be great to go watch a classic horror movie on there. It's going to be great to go watch horror movies whenever you want. But the unique programming that the Horror Channel is going to have isn't going to be like Sci-Fi's fucking Ghost Hunters. Do you understand that I have a major involvement in that channel? and that there are other people who have a creative ability and a creative vision, like Rob Zombie, who, yeah, he makes movies, but he makes movies that make you think, well, what the fuck, if I go here, you know, kind of like Texas Chainsaw Massacre, oh my God, if I go in the middle of the, you know, they play psychological warfare with you.
That's the point. I mean, Lou, that's a perfect example. What was that, 72, 73?
Yeah.
And then, wow, okay, let's remake it, and let's remake it again. Hollywood is about the most unimaginative group.
Yes, I understand that, but we're getting to a point here. And the point is that when you look at Hollywood today, you see all these remakes. I mean, I just saw a commercial on the air last night for Don't Answer the Door or some shit. You remember that one, or when a stranger knocks, or some shit? You know, the one where the babysitter's inside the house, and the guy says, "Are you alone?" You know?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, they're remaking that again.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, and it looks like the same friggin' one.
I understand
that, and you know, but you see, because of the lack of creativity in Hollywood, we are forced to look at these things and go, oh, wow, a remake of King Kong. Oh, that's going to be better than the other King Kong or the one before it. And so the average idiot is going to go out there and go, oh, yeah, well, let's go see King Kong because we're going to see if it outdoes the one before that.
I just can't stand that
stuff. I can't stand that either. And that's not what the Horror Channel is looking to do as far as their creativity is concerned. They're looking for groundbreaking stuff, new ideas. They're looking for people that have some kind of creativity in their body to make movies that are completely new ideas. The problem with Hollywood, naturally, is it's not what you know, it's who you know. And so if you convince somebody that you need to make a remake of When a Stranger Calls, and they're your best friend, you're going to get all the funding in the world for it.
Lou, it's a whole other world out there. I should talk to you off the air. The people that I've talked to, the people that I've been involved with, and I mean on a technical level and on a professional level. The producers, I could drop a bunch of films, and I will off the air to you.
Yeah.
But Lou, they don't have a creative bone in their body.
Mm-hmm.
They're leeches, and that's how they've made their money.
Right. But I understand. I'm just trying to make a point here with the Horror Channel. It's something different.
Maybe it's because maybe they got a passion or they love that kind of genre. And I guess at one point, you know.
But yeah, but do you understand something, though? The Horror Channel is the only network to say, Lou, whatever you want to do, you're in control. Now, what does that tell you?
Yeah, that's amazing if it's true. I mean,
Steve Barton was on the air. You can ask him. Next time he comes on the show, ask him. Say, did you tell Lou that he can do whatever he wants on the air? He has full creative control of doing whatever he wants.
And I tell you one thing, I sure wouldn't be running the old Hammer film. I'd be creating my own content and saying, look, this shit's real, you know?
But you have to understand, today is about money. Today is about proving content. You can't prove content with your own original programming. You just can't. It'd take way too much money.
Oh, you mean that?
For a startup network.
Yeah.
You can't just say, "Oh, we're the Horror Channel. Here's all our unique programming," because you're gonna be gambling your fucking money away, big time, more than if you're just trying to start the network up. So you have to say to people, "Well, you know, here's the, you know, it's like the Golf Channel. You know, I'm giving an example. All right, you know, we're gonna run the PGA tours, and we're gonna run this, and we're gonna run that, and we're gonna have this and that, and everything. They can prove their content real easy." But if the Golf Channel was to say, well, you know what, we're going to have like our own this and our own that, and they're going to package it and put it together, they're really, really, really running a risk. Because the first thing that these investors are going to say, well, these guys are a bunch of renegade loose cannons. That's how it is. It's all about money. So all I'm trying to do with the Horror Channel is, these people are not big business. These people are not in the category of wanting to remake every friggin' horror movie known to man. They're looking for creativity. That's the key with the Horror Channel. Creativity. They want people who have creative minds. How many movies did John Carpenter and Wes Craven make that were original ideas from them?
Well,
we're just talking about them.
You know what's funny? I was thinking about Carpenter the other day, and I was thinking, you know what? From Halloween to...
And understand, the sequels to Halloween were not John Carpenter.
Oh, I understand.
All right.
The original idea and thought, from Halloween to probably The Thing,
uh-huh,
were his best films.
But they were great films.
They were his best films.
Yeah.
They're fantastic movies. I really...
How about George Romero? You know, some people may complain, you know, about Land of the Dead. I thought Land of the Dead was really good.
Listen,
even though I made a comment a while ago that I didn't think that it was that good.
I happen to be, or was anyway, a real big zombie fan. I mean, the kind of stuff of like, you know, I had buddies reading this zombie survival guide and writing books about it, that kind of stuff.
Right.
Where we sit down and actually say, okay, dude, what would happen if the dead came alive? What would we do first? How would we fortify the house? You know, I used to do this with my cousins and my brother and all that sort of stuff. I used to have a blast of that stuff. So I was like, man, you know what? I don't think I'm going to see Land of the Dead, because that trilogy right now, and by the way, you know, Night of the Living Dead is in public domain.
Yeah, that's Night of the Living Dead, right. But I'm talking about Land of the Dead.
Right, I know. Well, look, Night of the Living Dead, Dawn of the Dead, and Day of the Dead are like the trilogy of zombies. I mean,
right.
That's it.
Right, and they're all unique in their own way.
And I was like, you know what? Every time Hollywood touches something, they're going to corrupt it. So I said, I don't know if I'm going to see Land of the Dead or not. And I haven't seen it yet.
Right.
So I don't know if I will.
Well, I mean, look at Creepshow. Did you like Creepshow?
There was that the one, The Crate, freaked me out a lot. The one little segment about The Crate that scared the hell out of me.
Oh, I know, it scared the shit out of me too.
Crate was just...
I had the opportunity. When was it? October. I talked to Ted Danson and the lady who played the other zombie character. I forget her friggin' name. I always do. But it was in the George Romero film Creepshow. And I straight up was sitting at the dinner table, and Ted Danson's off to the side, and everybody's eating dinner. I said to Ted, I said, yo. And he looked at me, and he says, what's your name again? I said, Lou Gentile. And he goes, oh, okay. He says, who are you with? You know, they all fucking question you when you're at these tables with these people. But anyway, I says to him, I says, when you were doing Creepshow, I said, what was the deal with that one scene where you were both dressed up as zombies and you're walking towards the camera? I said, were you guys laughing at each other? Because since I saw that over 15 years ago, I have always in my mind known that you guys were laughing. You were not being serious. You know what part I'm talking about?
No, I don't know.
When Ted Danson and the lady come in, you know, and after
he was holding his breath, right? Okay.
Yeah, exactly. And they're walking towards the camera, and you see them, and they look like they're laughing.
Yeah, I think, come to think of it, you're right.
And he sits there, and he looks at me, and he goes, you know, he's like, I haven't been asked that question in a long time. He said, but to answer you honestly, he said, Leslie Nielsen is about the funniest son of a bitch you've ever met. He says, and Leslie Nielsen would walk around the set with this little fart thing. And as we're walking towards the camera, he's behind the camera making these fart sounds. And you actually get to see, you know, the two of them laughing on camera. And they were so constrained for time, they didn't want to reshoot it because it just looked too good. And they didn't have the time, I guess, or whatever, but... That's what happened. So I mean,
yeah, that's cool. You know, what's funny. Actually, what's good is not Carpenter, but Romero did. He produced some great stuff. As a matter of fact, he produced a series back in television in the early '80s called.
Let me tell you something about George Romero.
Yeah,
I know George Romero personally.
Well,
okay, I've had dinner with this man twice.
I believe you.
Okay?
I believe you, Will. I believe you.
My researchers had dinner with this man, with me.
I believe you.
because I take my researchers with me because I believe in like the family bonding, the non-gay thing. Yeah. You know.
But did you see that series he produced, Tales from the Dark Side?
Yeah.
On TV.
Yeah.
There
loved
was
it.
Some really, really great episodes.
Oh yeah.
And Tom Savini directed some fantastic.
Well, we don't want to talk about Tom Savini on the show.
What's the matter with Savini? What do you got against him?
You ever met him?
No, I haven't.
Okay, well then you know why.
No, I haven't. I haven't.
You know. Do I really need to say anything about Tom Savini? You know, I tried to get Tom Savini. Let me tell you where it all started. I tried to get Tom Savini on the show back in 2000. And I called his house. And his daughter answers the phone. And I said, yeah, you know, I'd like to speak with Tom. And she was like, well, you know, may I ask who's calling? And I said, it's Lou Gentile from the Lou Gentile Show. And I hear him screaming in the background. What the fuck does he want? You know, da 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 da. Don't these fucking people know that I have a life? It's 7 o'clock at night. Okay?
That's too bad.
I hung the phone up. So when I went to Horror Find, I believe it was 2001, I went ahead and I confronted Tom. I said, Tom, I said, listen, I said, I tried to get you on my show 2 years ago or a year or whatever. I said, and you know, you're in the background yelling, you know, at me because I was on the phone. Not that you even knew me. You mean you didn't even know who the hell I was. You know, what the fuck am I doing bothering you at this time of night or whatever?
Well, maybe you had a real bad day.
You know, and that's fine. You know, but you know, Tom was like, he's like, well, you know, no problem. You know, here I'll give you my number and you can do it. And then he just blew me off. I got a real bad taste in my mouth. But
you picked up on a vibe then.
Yeah. And Tom just I never really hit it off with him.
Damn, that sucks. And he did some really good, episodes in that.
He did, but you know, Tom is a cameo actor. Okay.
Oh, yeah, he's not a lead, but look it, I mean, he directed that episode of The Closet. Now that thing scared the hell out of me.
Yeah. But I just got a bad taste in my mouth, and I'm not the only one. There's a buzz going around about him, and there's things that happen at these conventions that the public doesn't really know.
Well,
that, and I don't want to get into that, but I just got a bad taste, and he's friends with Romero, and I'm just like, you know, all right, whatever.
But what is he also, unfortunately? It's my rule.
A what?
It's my rule. He's not only a director or producer, but he's an actor.
I can tell you got a problem with actors.
Not just me, everybody.
Yeah, well.
Come on, Romero.
Look, I mean, I'll give you this. I'll say there are some actors out there that are real assholes, okay? But I'm a pretty good judge of character, and the people that I hang with, the actors and actresses that I know, that I hang with, because it's a small crowd of people, I mean, they're fine. And you know, you can think whatever you want, but I mean, you know, those people are fine.
Yeah, well, I'd say there's some good extraterrestrials out there too, but we only hear about the Greys mostly.
Yeah, well, you know, you live in Hollywood, so
yeah, I
what are you
going to
do
every day?
Yeah, you see that shit all the time, so it's very hard for you to look at it from where I'm coming from.
Well, I don't know. Maybe it's the people back east too. I mean, you guys just seem more down to earth. You seem more trustworthy to me than the people I. You know, a handshake out here means nothing. I mean,
right.
Literally nothing.
Exactly.
Yeah. Real bad taste in my mouth out here, yeah.
You know, but you can't do anything about it. I'm just telling you from my experiences with these people that, I mean, the celebrities that I know, I don't have a problem with. I really don't.
I just can't even stand that word.
I know that, but I'm just telling you what I encounter.
Yeah.
Like Sid Haig.
I'm glad it's the case for
me. I mean, look, sometimes Sid Haig will call me up out of the blue. I mean, it's not like a business relationship, like he wants to go on a...
They're just people.
I know they're just people, and that's what I try to get across to people.
I don't, it's funny that when I hear you talk about on the air, there are actually, what's funny to me is that when you say, I had dinner with these people, it's like, why in the fuck would I care about that?
Right.
I mean, some people in your listening audience will go, oh my gosh.
Exactly, and that brings up another point. Yes.
It's like,
when you, you know, when you sit there, when you see, you, and this is kind of difficult to explain.
I mean, if you said,
but you have people who are diehard fans. Now you got to understand, I have been at these conventions where, and the last one that I was out, I was actually helping George Romero out. Okay, and I was, you know, me and my researchers would come out there, and we would help, you know, my my agent and manager and all that other stuff do different things for different celebrities, and I did my thing and all that. I'm willing to help people, okay? So we're sitting there, and I saw all these fans coming up, and I'm sitting there saying to myself, oh, my God. You got one guy that comes up, oh, I can't believe I've gotten to meet you, you know, and this is incredible, oh, my God. You know, I've waited my whole life to meet you. This is you've inspired me. I did this and that and all that. And George is just sitting there like, oh, yeah, all right, no problem. What they fail to realize is, like you said, these celebrities are people. They live and breathe. They don't have money for gas like we do. Sometimes they have money for gas. They take a shit like we do. They stub their toe like we do. Everything's the same.
Yeah, but isn't it amazing to you that we get together as a society, as a culture, and say, okay, let's put that person up there. For that person, when a film is shot, you're lucky to get 2 minutes out of the day on a production.
Right.
Every other time is the people behind the camera. And that's even on production. Forget it. Post-production, it takes 5 times longer with a film. But that's here nor there. The point is that they'll get up there, and we collectively say, okay, let's all pretend together that that person isn't who they say they are.
Right.
And they're actually somewhere else.
Oh, yeah, that's why I like watching the movies of these people that I know, because I get to see their real personality come out for a couple seconds. You know what
Give
I mean?
Give me a break. I mean, like I said, I would... How in the world is that interesting to anybody? I can't watch a film anymore and go, oh, wow, that's interesting. You know, I actually believe that person is that person.
Yeah.
I mean... To hear a story about a case you were on where a friggin' Ouija board is disappearing and reappearing in your house, give me a break. That scares the shit out of me.
Right.
But to pretend, oh, I'm a chainsaw killer and I've got all these heads. Give me a break. This is just stupid, man. Why do we even value that shit?
I think I found your button.
Yeah.
That and Sylvia Brown.
You really did.
I found two buttons. Sylvia Brown and actors and actresses in Hollywood.
Fuck the hell out of me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm going to be playing these buttons.
No. Just, please, just talk about your Ouija board.
I'm going to be playing your buttons.
Let's have another verbal kaleidoscope.
You know, you can stick that, man.
Gotta admit, though, that was a great liner he did.
It was.
That was absolutely awesome. That just came out of nowhere. But yeah, I mean, I understand.
That's another listener who honestly cares. I mean, honestly wants to know more and is excited. You know.
What's this?
I said that what he was talking about, Jin Jin. That was after her call.
Yeah.
And that's another person, another listener. That like I said, these people are infinitely more interesting to me than any of these celebrities and actors.
Yeah.
I can't stand that.
I know.
I mean, I want to know more about Al. I want to know more about Lyle. I want to know more about everybody in there.
Sinbad?
Jane and Mountain Girl and Zilla.
About Sinbad? You want to know more about Sinbad?
I just think Lyle's great.
He is.
I think he'd be great with some voiceover stuff.
And isn't that awesome though? How you know, now that we have some of the pictures of these people in the chat room, you can associate what they look like.
It's just ridiculous. I mean, I just did a thing last week with Queen Latifah, right?
Yeah.
Whoop-de-doo, I am 50,000 more times more interested in coming back and seeing what Lyle's got to say or what Al's been drinking. I am. I swear to God.
Yeah. Well, you know, hey, to each his own.
Dude, it is real. It's real stuff.
I know.
Someone, oh well, you know, who am I dating? Who? Fuck that. Sorry. Oh, well, listen to me.
So you going to tell me what you do or what?
Nah, I'll tell you off the air.
Oh, okay.
That's not happened, but I'll tell you off the air. But
no, but I mean, I understand what you're talking about. If you got to deal with it on a daily basis, you know, I'm sure that you see the whole thing.
No, but it isn't even that, Lou. Everybody should realize that. I mean, from all my encounters, they care about, and you know how much even rich people, I mean, really rich people, how narcissistic these people are.
Yeah.
And actors too. I would literally on the weekends. I used to all the time see. I could drop 50 names right now. Sidney Poitier, Don Rickles, James Woods. All these people would get together on the weekends with some very rich people, and they'd all go watch movies at their home privately. And
it's called networking.
What's that?
It's called networking and funding.
I'm telling you, man, it's the most narcissistic
thing
in the world. It's disgusting. And these people, they love even the celebrities, that, as we call them, they love to watch about what other people are saying about them.
Right.
You know? But they cut out clippings in the magazines. They collect these things.
Do you listen? Yeah, I'm just going to bring this up. But do you listen to Howard Stern?
No, I don't. I don't, honestly.
All right. Well, today, it was absolutely probably the funniest show that I've heard in a while, but the most real show.
He's got more to say than much more interesting than that guy, Luke.
But wait! I want you to listen. I mean, I listen to him in my truck going to work.
Yeah, but I think he's past the point, man. He's a celebrity now.
I know, and I understand that. But I just listen to the show, and there are parts of the show that I just think are pretty neat. But he does things that I think are pretty cool. Like kind of how I do it, and I'm not saying I'm a Howard Stern in any way, okay. But my point here is that what he did was he was supposed to have this guest on, I forget her name, and she was married to what the hell is this guy's name, David Bowie.
Mm-hmm.
She was on Star Search or some shit or whatever the hell it was.
I know who David Bowie is. I don't know who he's married to.
All right, well, she was married to him or something like that. And I could have even that wrong. I don't know. But anyway, this is her claim to fame, and she goes ahead and she was to make an appearance today. Well, because they're now, you know, they're now on Sirius, and they have cameras in their studio, you know, for their on-demand stuff. They go ahead and they you know, they're waiting for this lady to get here, this actress, and they can't find her. And then her publicist comes out and says, you know, that they can't have any cameras, she's not ready to go on camera, and all this crazy shit. He starts, you know, screaming and yelling, you know, get her in here, and all this other stuff. And then the next thing you know, she shows up, and there's a camera there, and she doesn't want to get on TV. And she's like, no way. And Howard flipped out, literally, on the air, because this chick did not want to go on the air and be seen. Because she was not ready for TV. This is how fake these people are.
But Lou, that's normal. That's standard,
yeah.
Man.
Oh, I know.
That's absolutely standard. You know, I mean, not.
But
the
it's
only
just
time I ever listened to Stern was when he had a television show years ago, and that's when that Stuttering John was on, and that was funny.
Yeah.
That stuff was funny.
Oh yeah.
But I don't know. It's just, yeah. God, please, no more talk of celebrities. It's just the worst in the world. I can't stand that gossip crap. Every time that E channel's on, it's just,
yeah.
Man, it's all I can do to run for the remote and turn it off.
I know, but that's cool. A world that we've created, though.
Yeah, well, thank God for TiVo. And I heard the replay, man. You got yourself a DVR, huh?
Yeah. Hey, you heard that, huh?
Yeah, I did.
Did you hear my Dish Network scam?
Yeah, I heard that whole thing about what the hoops you had to jump through for that damn thing.
Yeah, it was actually because of you that I did that. I said to myself, you know, I ain't putting $600 out for this thing. I'm just going to call them up and tell them that DirecTV offered me a DVR.
Well, all I can say is I hope that. Well, they actually would have, man. But I just hope that you. I just hope that you can. You know, it's like a TiVo unit, and you can do your wish list, and you can get it all recorded, you know?
Well, I mean, according, you know, the damn thing still hasn't gotten here. You know, the cheap bastard sent it out, you know, like 5-day UPS or something.
Luke, they're $99, dude. I'll go buy you one.
No. The ones that work with Dish Network, they're specific for it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can't use a TiVo. I already had one. Yeah, I would. The night that you talked about that, I would have went out and bought one that night.
Yeah, we got to get you both networks, man.
But Dish, I like Dish. I really do like Dish Network. I have no problems with them. I think they're a great company. The signal's great. I mean, when I had DirecTV, I just didn't like it. And you know, I got caught up in a bunch of shit a couple years ago with them people because they were just, they're insane. But you know, the bottom line of what I was talking about with this DVR is that, you know, the thing is proprietary to it, and it supposedly works pretty good. And they gave it to me, and they're sending it out.
As long as you have, I mean, I've got an older cable unit. As long as you have that thing, it'll work with any cable box. It'll work with anything. It's just a little cable in the back that will send the RF, the infrared, and change the channels for you and record. You know, it'll change the box for you.
Yeah, but you need to have the programming and all that on it.
Yeah, but it'll still do that. You're going to need a phone connection still, probably.
No, not for this one.
Really?
This is all integrated.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't have any monthly subscription fees or nothing with it.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, they're just sending it out. It's like the $600 what's the namer? The $600 dual tuner thing.
Oh yeah, that's what I can do on mine too. I love that. Yeah. I absolutely love that. You can watch one channel and record another.
Yeah, exactly.
But I hardly ever do that. All I do is, I mean, if I turn the TV on, it's because I'm going to watch something I've recorded on TiVo.
Yeah, is it me, or is it that the people at Radio Shack are really now becoming, like, nerdy retards?
No, they're numbskulls, number one. And number two, they never have anything in stock when the things you want.
Yeah.
Or if they do, it's an open box and it's returned. That's the last thing I want.
I mean, it's just crazy. You know, you go into Radio Shack these days, and they're just like, you know, I'll tell them, I'll be like, yeah, I need this. I'm looking for... I forget. I think I was looking for microphone wind covers. And they're like, oh, we don't sell them, man. I think you're going to have to go to a recording studio or something for one of them. I'm like, douchebag, I was on your website. You got them. Yeah. And I've seen them lying in these stores collecting dust for years.
Bingo.
I'm looking around the store. What do I find? Like all the way in the back of something, I find them.
Yeah.
I found like a 10-pack for $3. I don't know, it's just retarded.
As much as they get ripped on, man, they have really come through for electronic-wise as far as, like, in the last minute or putting in a cinema. I used to do installs for Metropolitan Theaters, these big installs.
Right.
Where we used to get the, you know, these big 10-plexes up and running, you know, and for the times we needed them, man, Radio Shack was a great thing to have.
Oh, yeah. Well, I can tell you this. There are people in the UK, my listeners out there in Great Britain and UK and all that have watched Channel 4 and all that. There's another instance where somebody was part of one of my TV shows or, you know, documentaries, whatever it is, that is going to be bringing Lou Gentili over to the UK pretty soon.
Hmm.
So within the next couple of months, I'm going to say probably within the next 6 months, you're going to see some stuff over there.
You mean as far as on television?
Yeah.
That's great.
Mm-hmm.
That's great, man. Well, you already got a listener now, at least one. I know Jambo in there.
Nah, there's a bunch of them. There's Jambo, Lewis, there's... I mean, I've... Get... See, one thing you got to understand about the UK is when they air the Terror That Comes in the Night on Channel 4, I get flooded with emails from the UK.
That's great, man.
Flooded with them. And it happens like every 4 months I get flooded with emails from the UK. So
I might have seen that. Was that the one where they reenacted the those night attacks?
Mm-hmm.
And the guy said that he got sodomized by something?
Yep.
And actually, some of that recreation was pretty damn scary.
Uh-huh.
That big, like that tall black thing that would like move at really quick speeds.
Yeah,
I remember that. That was
kind
of freaky.
Yeah.
How were you involved with that?
Because I did the case.
Oh, okay. Shit.
I actually uncovered that the priest was a pedophile and that he was I uncovered in that case, behind the scenes, that the priest was a pedophile. He was excommunicated by the Vatican. The Pope actually did it to him. And that he was a convicted armed robber.
See, now this is the kind of thing that I want to shut up and listen to you talk.
Yeah, well, that was a fucking nightmare. I talked about this before. You must have missed it.
Fill me in, because I do not remember this case.
Probably in August of 2001, 1 month before 9/11. Kevin and I went to New York to do a case for the Learning Channel where a kid was getting attacked in the middle of the night by an unknown force. And I was involved from the beginning when they first got in contact with this kid, and I made the suggestion that, you know, let's try and make this as credible as possible. And let's have this kid go to the best sleep clinics in the United States and verify what's going on. And if they come back and they say that it's unexplainable, then we have something. You know, I mean, it's common sense. They can't figure out what the hell's going on, and there's something happening that's paranormal. So they sent this kid around the United States, and I think he went to two research clinics, and both of them said, we have no idea what's happening here. Something's going on, we just don't know.
So they witnessed
the kid would be thrown out of the bed. The kid would have handprints on his stomach. His stomach would be pushed in as if something was punching him. Some real wild stuff. And they went ahead and they finally, after about 4 months of testing with this kid, brought him back to New York where he lived. And the production company wanted me to go out there for the weekend and find out what's going on. And so they picked me up and brought me up to New York. Kevin and I stayed in a hotel and ordered all kinds of food and everything else. And we went and we investigated this place, and I found out that the kid was getting attacked by something that the priest... You see, you have to understand, this kid was living in a, I don't want to say a halfway house, but kind of like a boys' home, you know, where you go, where, you know, if your parents die, you know, they put you in there by the church.
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of where he was living. But the thing was, is that for some reason, somehow, some way, the Vatican had excommunicated this priest about 6 years prior to this. And this, I don't know if I want to go into certain places with this, but bottom line was is that the priest was more into demonology than I was, and he was into Santeria and many different things, and he was in order to keep having sex with this kid. Who, mind you, was underage at the time. When it was happening, he stopped it when he was 18. But this priest was having sex with this kid, and the only way to keep the kid around him was to use dark forces in order to keep him there.
What a sick
and bastard. I went in there, and that's the one where I went in there on national TV and took the recorder and laid it down and started asking questions. And got some really crazy replies when I started, you know, asking it to leave in the name of Jesus Christ and things like that. And forensic experts analyzed it, and they said, well, there's, you know, there's only two ways it could happen. Either Lou is talking into the recorder, or he has some kind of a device that he's using to manipulate the recording, both of which were not present. And that was a nice way of saying that it was real. You know, because society, if they would have said that this was real, would have just thought it was bullshit anyway. But you know, the recordings were real.
This is an ordained. This is a priest who's in the Catholic Church.
This is a Roman Catholic priest that has a place in New York City that is a home for boys. And when he he went to jail for 5 years. Another priest watched the place. They excommunicated the priest while he was in jail, because while he was in there, they found out that he was banging all the kids. And the next thing you know, they went ahead and they excommunicated him while he was in prison. And at the same time, when he got out, somehow, some way, he slipped through the cracks, and the church just gave him this house with all the kids in it and stuff like that. It was just crazy. You know, I don't want to get into real graphic or real hardcore information, because there are some people from the Vatican that were involved with this when I was doing this case that tried to hush it up because
Are you serious?
No, I'm dead serious. I've never heard from this kid again after.
This is sickening.
Yeah, well, you know, the Vatican has a way of you know, when certain things get released to the public. I didn't say this on the air, but it got back to the Vatican of what I uncovered, because I have access to things that most people do not have access to. And when I found out about it, talked to certain people, I guess somebody leaked the word out, and they sent a particular well-known exorcist representative in the United States to go meet with this kid. And I was actually getting ready to have him go down to Maryland with me to be hypnotized, because it was a very touchy situation. You couldn't give this kid an exorcism because it would be way too dangerous, I thought. And so what I wanted to do is I wanted to have a priest there with me and hypnotize this kid.